John, try to say this name.
Oh, that's so easy. Anastasia. I know that. I knew that one. Anastasia, I knew. Hadjivassiliou.
Yeah, you see?
Got it.
Down to a T.
Anastasia Hadjivassiliou.
After 1 year.
This is Dr. Hadjivassiliou. We were fellows together. Fellowship is like the final year of subspecialty training to become an interventional radiologist. It's also the most grueling year. Interventional radiology is doing minimally invasive surgeries using image guidance.
We do several procedures through small incisions. We keep patients out of the hospital and get them home as quickly as possible.
Dr. Chris here, back for another episode of the vlog. A couple months ago, you may recall that Dr. John and I were in LA for the SIR conference. Link up here if you missed that video. We ran into a couple of my old friends, one being Dr. John Chung, who was my old program director in Vancouver where I did fellowship. And we also spoke with Dr. Anastasia Hadjivassiliou. She's one of my old co-fellows who went through the program with me. We're gonna talk a little bit about the pathway to become an interventional radiologist. Well, right now there's interventional radiology residencies, which is sort of the new pathway, but when I went through, you do med school, which is 4 years, you do a 5 year residency in diagnostic radiology, and then you do a 1 year, 1 to 2 year fellowship in interventional radiology. So for people who are in their residency and are gonna be applying for fellowship, or even people who are in their fellowship now, we're gonna talk a little bit about what our experiences were like. Flashback to SIR again, but we're gonna, instead of showing you the conference this time, we're just gonna reminisce a little bit about what fellowship's all about and how it's sort of the final year before you become a certified interventional radiologist.
So we're here with Dr. Hadjivassiliou.
Hadjivassiliou?
Hadjivassiliou. Apparently I can't say it after a year. So Anastasia and I, we were co-fellows in Vancouver together. We started on July 1st, 2016 and went to June 30th, 2017. The four of us basically thrown into this program together, and on day one we started essentially not knowing anything. And by the end of it, the expectation was you'd be able to practice as an independent interventional radiologist. It was a good year, but it was a long and grueling year. Like, how would you describe fellowship year?
I think it's a really hard year. Very rewarding by the end of it, because you can definitely see that you're getting pretty good at what you're doing in comparison to where you started from. It's very hard work, very long hours, if you remember.
What would your typical day be like?
We used to start around 6:30 in the morning. I prepare all the patients for rounds.
So rounds would be from 7:30 to 8, and essentially it was our staff for the day, who was like the boss. We would present all of the cases to them. You would have to have your ducks in a row. You'd have to know exactly what you were doing, why you were doing it, how you were going to do it, and you'd have to present everything in a succinct plan. So, you know, this is a 37-year-old patient with blah, 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 presents with this, and the plan for the intervention is this. The reason why we're doing it is this, and this is how we're gonna do it. You show the relevant imaging, and then they put you on trial by fire. It can be intimidating if you don't have thick skin. It was like every day, we're just getting grilled in rounds. And by the end of it, the knowledge gets pounded into you by brute force.
And it was a little bit scary for us at the beginning. At the end, it was what we needed. Getting that ingrained, then you're able to make some safe decisions.
We've only gotten actually to 8 a.m. in the day. You got your cases ready to go for rounds at 7:30. You've consented your patients. In addition to having all of your cases preloaded on the computer for rounds presentation, you would have your first patient prepped, consented, and ready to go, so that the nurses and the techs get the patient on the table, so they're, boom, ready to go at 8 a.m. Would you get time to eat lunch?
What's lunch?
Exactly.
In all fairness, we were really well looked after. So there were busy days where, you know, you were off your feet all day, but I think our bosses were brilliant. They would always check in on us and make sure that we had something, you know, to eat and drink, and we had energy to keep doing what we were doing.
A lot of people in medicine, everything's a competition, because that's how you're groomed. Trying to get into med school, you know, you're in your undergrad. Yeah. Everybody's gunning for those few seats in med school. Everyone views everyone else as competition. But then you get into med school, and then people are trying to get ahead and graduate on top of their class. And that's how you're trained for, you know, you're classically conditioned to do that. But then you get into fellowship, and all of a sudden you've got three other people who are all in the same position as you, and you have a choice. You can either view them as competition, or you can view them as your brothers and sisters and try to help each other out. I think that the four of us, we had a very good relationship that way. You know, you would be bringing coffee down to all of us, and I'd be scrubbing the kids like, oh, thank you, you know, and vice versa. 6:30 a.m. to 6 p.m. is 11 and a half hours.
The cases were happening over 10 hours, but the whole day, from the moment you left home to the moment that you went back home,
it was more like 16 hours.
Yeah.
You might finish your last case case, you're at 5 or 6 p.m.
Yes.
But then you have to do the dictations and the reports, because that's what your responsibility is. You have to send your reports to your attending. If you didn't get a chance to dictate your reports to send to them during the day in between cases, then you would have to do them all at the end of the day, which may take an hour. In addition to that, the CT scans, the MRIs, that specifically look at the blood vessels, we were responsible for those too.
Yep.
If you didn't get them done during the day, we have to do them at the end of the day. Only after that could you then be finished for that day's work. And if you were smart, you'd start prepping your cases for the next day.
You left out the meetings. We had to prepare for it after what Chris has mentioned, preparing for the day job, we had to prepare for the meeting. So a lot of times during the fellowship, we would find ourselves maybe staying until 1 or 2 a.m.
Sometimes you'd get lucky and have like 20 cases to prep. Other times you'd get unlucky and have 45 cases to prep. Classic North American stream to become an IR. You do an undergrad, so it's 4 years after high school. Then you do 4 years of medical school. Then you do a 5-year diagnostic radiology residency. And then you do 1 to 2 years of interventional radiology fellowship. So what we're talking about is that last phase, that one last 1 year of fellowship. It's the most grueling out of all of those steps. That's the pathway I took. The pathways are changing now, so you can go to the SIR website. I'll link it below. There's new IR residencies that are coming out. Put a lot of hard work in and you get a lot of it out of it. We were very lucky to train with all of them.
Yeah.
Tell me about John Chung. Who is John Chung?
Well, John Chung is like the best program director we could ever ask for.
We've actually ran into John Chung here today.
Get out of the camera right now.
Okay. Do you have John and John session?
So we're going to talk a little bit about what Chris was like in fellowship. I think that's really so all the juicy information we can get about Chris as a fellow. Tell me about Chris, his first day of fellowship. That's what I want to hear about.
Oh, I was probably late, so I can't even remember. Chris dresses very well. He'd come in a suit with a tie.
Shut up, I wear scrubs.
Chris, you gotta change it to scrubs.
He's making that up, that did not happen.
Talk about that case that Chris did in a full tuxedo.
No, he was a great fellow, worked hard, turned out well, you like him.
That's up for debate.
As program director.
I'm so surprised that Chris is trying to take over the camera again. You see this?
Well, let's talk about one more thing about Vancouver, and let's talk about fellowship, and let's talk about Twitter. Becky?
As program director, you see a lot of fellows.
For me, it's a privilege to get to be a program director. I get to be at the forefront of watching these young physicians come in, basically not know what they're doing.
I think that was directed towards you, Chris.
And then at the end of it, come out and be semi-legitimate.
Semi-legitimate?
All kidding aside, I think it's a fantastic opportunity for me to be involved in training and helping groom these people who are going to go out and help many others.
What are the attributes that you look for, first of all, in the interview process?
Do they have two hands?
Okay, so Chris got past that part.
Got two hands, that's good, okay.
And then I had a new thing I did this year with interviewees that made them peel a banana.
Are you kidding me?
I'm not joking. A banana I had sitting that was very mushy.
That's
you gotta
great.
Make sure they have good hands, right?
I'm still not completely clear on how Chris got in, but.
Okay, being serious now, how genuinely they're interested in IR. If they're interested in IR itself and not so much the city, then that's golden, right?
Yep.
If they understand that it's going to be an arduous training year, they're not going to be there for fun. They're going to be there and staying until 8 o'clock, maybe after midnight sometimes. Probably see their spouse or significant other every couple months at most. No, but if they're aware of what they're getting themselves into and they are enthusiastic about it, I think that's a great trait.
I hope that kind of gave you guys a little bit of insight as to what fellowship's all about. Key people involved in our fellowship. This guy here who made it great.
Sounds great.
Thanks again, John. Thanks, Anastasia. Sarel, what's your channel all about? He's got a YouTube channel.
Sarel GarmD. It's on YouTube.
We're going to link it up there.
It's basically started out being about radiology education. Started out being about kind of how to look at CTs, how to look at MRIs, things that people care about. And sort of branched off from there into kind of whatever I was doing professionally. So I started out in radiology residency, started moving into fellowship, thinking about IR. So then I started trying to show what are IR procedures about. And as we talked about before, one thing about IR is that it's this amazing specialty. It's a surgical specialty, very nuanced, very high tech, but just not well known to the public. One of the videos I posted, it was very simple to record. I recorded a portacath insertion. That's a procedure that you can pretty much do as a resident. I recorded that, and since I think 2014, that's generated almost 200,000 views. I'd say I've done a lot more of that, but that would be a huge area of growth. It's just recording procedures and having patients and physicians and other people just understand them.
You've brought up a lot of interesting points because I tried to get a video series off the ground at my previous institution, and there was so much red tape, filming in the hospital.
Yeah,
no one wanted to be on board.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't until I found the group I'm with now who really embraced that. So did you find similar kickback?
Yeah. You know, I guess obviously there's a generational gap. There's people that are in power that don't know the power of social media, they don't understand it, or they sort of want to ignore it. Still, they did allow me to do it. They did allow me to post it online.
So that's great. So we're going to link to his channel down below in the description box. Yeah. Great meeting you, man.
Yeah, that's been good, man.
Yeah, awesome. So there you have it. We spoke a little bit about fellowship. I hope that kind of clears up the mystery of how people become interventional radiologists. If you're in your last year of training and you're in your fellowship, best of luck. Trust me, there's a light at the end of the tunnel. And for now, I'm Dr. Chris, and we'll see you in the next case.